إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا وسيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلن تجد له وليا مرشدا، ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، ونشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. اللهم صلي وسلم وأنعم وأكرم وبارك على حبيبنا وشفيعنا وملاذنا وقرة عيوننا محمد صلوات ربي وسلامه عليه. اللهم صلي وسلم وبارك عليه في الأولين، وصلي وسلم وبارك عليه في الآخرين، وصلي وسلم وبارك عليه في الملأ الأعلى إلى يوم الدين. يقول عز من قائل: يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء، واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام، إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. In the name of Allah, the gracious, the merciful, to Him we belong and to Him we shall return. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in His infinite wisdom and boundless mercy to send an abundance of prayers and peace upon our beloved messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to have mercy upon us and to have mercy upon our parents and to have mercy upon this ummah. Ya Allah, we beg you and we beseech you that you have mercy upon us, that you shower us with your grace, and that you guide us to that which is pleasing to you, and that you make us of those that on the day of judgment you will be pleased with us. Ya Allah, we beg you and we beseech you that you make that the case for us, for our families, for our parents, and for this ummah. Ya Rabbi Al-Alameen. Brothers and sisters, one of the great sages of our past, a pious predecessor from the Tabi'een, and the Tabi'een are those who inherited from the companions, is a man by the name of Malik ibn Dinar. And for those of you who know this name, you know what he means in our Islamic intellectual tradition. He is a giant. He is known as Al-Alim al-Nazar, a scholar who put down principles and dictates for us to follow. We read in our books, Malik ibn Dinar says such and such, his wisdoms and his guidance and his teachings. He's a giant of our past. And he was a man who lived in Basra, in Iraq. And he lived during the time of another great sage, a man by the name of Al-Hasan al-Basri. And one day, Al-Hasan al-Basri asks Malik ibn Dinar, and he says, "Can you please tell the people your story?" Because Malik ibn Dinar has a very particular story. So he asks him, "Can you please tell the people your story? And if you can do it on Friday." And so the next Friday, Malik ibn Dinar, this giant of a scholar, is now sitting in the masjid in Basra, in Iraq. And he's sitting in front of the people, and he begins to relay to them his story. And I want you to pay close attention to the story because it pays such critical tribute to the challenges that we face on individual levels. He says about himself, "For 30 years, I was a wretched man. I was a drunkard. I drank all the time. I was a thief. I was a qati'u tariq. I would stop people in the road and I would steal from them. I was someone who engaged in interest. I engaged in every single vice known." For 30 years of his life, he says, "That was my reality. I loved to drink. I loved to abuse people. I was oppressive, belligerent, and nasty." Subhanallah, Malik ibn Dinar. This is what he's saying about himself. And he was an overseer of the markets. And of course, this was a prime opportunity for him to oppress and steal from people. So he says that one day he walked out and he said, "I wanted to see a fight. I thirsted to see people fighting with each other." He liked to see people in that state. So he went to the market and he heard a man who was yelling and screaming. So he went to watch and observe. And when he happened upon this man, the man was telling a seller, "How can you steal from me? How can you take from me? You took from me farhata banati. You took from me what was going to bring joy to my daughter's hearts. How could you do this?" And so the seller starts laughing at him. What, you're nothing. What are you going to do about it? So the man said, I will have my daughters make dua on you. And so the man laughs. He says, what does that mean to me? And then the man says to the seller, don't you know that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says that a man who leaves his house to purchase something to bring joy and happiness to the faces of his children, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala yanzuru ilayhi bi'ayn ar-ridha, that a person who goes out to purchase something to bring joy to his children's hearts or her children's hearts, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala looks upon that person with an eye of acceptance and pleasure. And so Malik ibn Dinar is watching this. And he says, something happened in my heart as observing this. It would have never affected him to hear such words. But a moment, something settled in his heart. And so then rather than instigating the fight further, he went and he grabbed the seller. And he disciplined him. And he said, give the man all that he asks for and more. And so the man takes what was owed to him. And then he turns to Malik and he says, thank you. Jazakallahu khayra. May Allah give you goodness. He says, please don't thank me. But I have one request. This is a man who is a drunkard, who's wretched, who's vile, who's abusive, who's a thief. But he says to the man, he says, I have one request. Please ask your daughters to make dua for Malik ibn Dinar. Something settled in his heart to ask that question. That night he went home and he said, how beautiful was that sight? A man who loved his daughters. I wish I could have a daughter that I could love. I want you to think about this. The man didn't do anything special. All he did was act in accordance to how the Prophet taught him to act. The man went to the market to buy something for his kids. That's all. That was all that was needed to instigate something in the heart of Malik ibn Dinar. Nothing was said beyond that. At night, Malik now is reflecting upon that man and his daughters. And he says, I wish I could have a daughter and children who could bring pleasure to my heart in that way. But he said, I am the worst person in town. Who would ever allow me to marry their daughter? So he goes and he purchases a slave woman and he frees her and he marries her. And he has from her a child, a daughter by the name of Fatima. And Fatima became the apple of his eye. His entire life revolved around this girl, Fatima, his young, beautiful daughter. He used to love to rush home to see her and to be with her. He said, however, I didn't stop my vices. I kept on doing what I was doing. I would drink and drink. And even Allah would send me signs. My daughter, 2 years old, would crawl on my lap and hit the alcohol from my hand. But I still drank. Subhanallah. Then he says, one day, when she was roughly around the age of 4 or 5, some narrations say, he came home and he learned that she had died. And he said, it was the most devastating moment of my life. And I became so angry with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How could Allah take away my daughter? And so he said, and some narrations say that this was the night of Ramadan, the first night of Ramadan. He says, لَأَفْجُرَنَّ اللَّيْلَ كَمَا لَمْ أَفْجُرْ مِنْ قَبْلِ. He says, tonight I will engage in vice like I have never engaged in vice before. Allah is going to take my daughter? Then watch. And he drank and he drank and he drank until he says he completely passed out. And when he passed out, he said, I had a dream. I found myself and it was the day of judgment. I woke up and it's the day of judgment. And it's an overwhelming sight. And I hear a munadi, a caller saying, Ya Malik ibn Dinar, halumma lil ardi ala al jabbar. Oh Malik ibn Dinar, come. It is time to stand in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he hears these words and he says, of course, I am nowhere near ready to stand in front of Allah. And then he says, I see a serpent, a huge snake, massive, rushing towards me to devour me. So I begin to run and run and run until I happen upon an old, very frail man wearing a white garment. He says, Ya Shaykh Ya Kabir, O old man, please save me, help me, adrikni, save me from the serpent. The old man says, I'm too weak, there's nothing I can do for you. And so he begins to run and continue to run until he happens upon the precipice of hellfire. And the serpent is right behind him. And then he says, Kittu an ulqi bi nafsi fiha. I almost threw myself into the hellfire. However, I turned back and I ran again. And I met the old man again. I said, please save me. He said, I can't do anything for you. But perhaps go to that mountainside, that hillside. Maybe there's something there for you. So the man ran, Malik ibn Dinar ran towards the hillside. And that was known as Wada'i' al-Muslimin, where the Muslims' trusts were placed. So he ran and a curtain raised, and he saw a sea of children's faces. And the serpent is right behind him. And then the children begin to yell, Ya Fatima, adriki abaki. Oh Fatima, save your father. And so Fatima runs and she holds her father with her right hand and she puts her left hand out towards the serpent and she said, Ilayka Anna, stay away from us. And of course you can imagine now Malik is exhausted. The serpent turns away and he sits down and his beautiful young child Fatima sits on his lap. And he asks her, now this is the father asking the daughter for guidance. Said, what was that? What was that serpent? She said, Father, that serpent was your bad deeds. Your deeds that you kept on increasing and increasing, and you never did anything about it. So it became so large that it seeks to destroy you. And then he asked, what was that old man? She said, that old man, those were your good deeds. So few and frail and weak and can barely help you. And then she said to him, she uttered the beautiful words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and she said, أَلَمْ يَأْنِ لِلَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَن تَخْشَعَ قُلُوبُهُمْ لِذِكْرِ اللَّهِ وَمَا نَزَلَ مِنَ الْحَقِّ. She said, Father, is it not time that those who believe, that their hearts become humble and submissive to the remembrance of Allah and what He revealed from truth? Is it not time? And so he says, I woke up. And it was the time of Salatul Fajr. And he said, I was overwhelmed by the dream that I saw. So I ran to the masjid in Basra. And probably Hassan al-Basri was probably leading prayer. And the first verse that he hears are the verses from Surah Al-Hadid. أَلَمْ يَأْنِ لِلَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَن تَخْشَعَ قُلُوبُهُمْ لِذِكْرِ اللَّهِ وَمَا نَزَلَ مِنَ الْحَقِّ وَلَا يَكُونُ كَالَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْكِتَابَ مِنْ قَبْلِ وَلَا يَكُونُ كَالَّذِينَ And let them not be like those who received the book from before them. And they فَطَالَ عَلَيْهِمُ الْأَمَدِ And the time was long. فَقَسَتْ قُلُوبُهُمْ And their hearts became hard. وَكَثِيرٌ مِّنْهُمْ فَاسِقُونَ And many of them are disobedient. He happened upon the masjid. He heard these words of Surah Al-Hadid. And then he fell to his knees. And he declared to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, أَنَا يَا رَبْ أَنَا يَا رَبْ أَنَا يَا رَبْ The time has come, Ya Allah. The time has come. The time has come. I submit to you, Ya Allah. I have transgressed time and time again for over 30 years of my life. But now the time has come. And subhanallah, after so many signs that he had received, he had the resolve in that moment to turn to Allah. And that was the beginning of his journey to become one of the greatest of our predecessors. The man that we turn to for guidance to understand the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Malik ibn Dinar. Brothers and sisters, Malik's story is not the story of a distant person that is disconnected. No. A lot of times when we reference the stories of people of past, we'll say, well, they're far behind. How many of us can truly relate to the struggle of Malik? Many of us can. A man for over 30 years who was a tabi'i, who sat with Anas ibn Malik. He sat with Anas ibn Malik, the servant of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. He struggled to be guided and to be good. He struggled, a very real struggle. The struggle that all of us go through. And so the question that is resoundingly obvious that we must negotiate is, أَلَمْ يَأْنِ لِلَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. Is it not time? See, this is, as Ibn Abbas says, عِتَابٌ رَبَّانِي. This is a gentle reproach from Allah, our Lord, our Creator. Allah, in His mercy, and because He loves us, He, in a very gentle manner, reproaches us. He says, أَلَمْ يَأْنِي. Is it not time? For those who believe, أَن تَخْشَعَ قُلُوبُهُمْ لِذِكْرِ اللَّهِ, that their hearts become in surrender and humble to the remembrance of Allah. Is it not time, Allah is saying? Subhanallah. It is an indication of how much Allah loves us, that He doesn't give up. And He keeps on saying, it's time. وَمَا نَزَلَ مِنَ الْحَقِّ. Allah is saying, I have revealed to you the truth. You're going to go around searching for truth in other places. A lot of us, we establish lifestyles that are disconnected from Allah. Whether it's in pursuing our careers, an idea of ourselves and our families, the things that we want. And it's done independent of Allah. So Allah is saying, stop. Stop what you're doing. I've revealed to you the truth. لا تتبعوا السبل فتفرق بكم عن سبيله. Don't follow these different pathways, because that's the nature of the dunya. Allah lays out many pathways that can be followed, but all of them do not lead to Allah except one, Sabilullah. And so Allah says, find that path and stick to it and be moved by it. Let your heart tremble. وَجِلَتْ قُلُوبُهُمْ. When they hear the name of Allah, their hearts tremble, because they are people who seek the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and no one else. And so Allah says, and don't be like those who received the book from before you. There are those who received the guidance before you. فَطَالَ عَلَيْهِمُ الْأَمَدْ. And a long period passed while they had the guidance in their hand. فَقَسَتْ قُلُوبُهُمْ. Their hearts became hard. Guidance, they had it. They had it for such a long time. But they let it go. They just let it stay there on the shelf. And so their hearts became hard. And so Allah says, وَكَثِيرٌ مِّنْهُمْ فَاسِقُونَ. Why does Allah say that many of them are not devout? Many of them are fasiqun, wrongdoers, evildoers. Because when you receive the guidance and you don't follow it, one of the biggest tricks of the shaitan is that he makes you think that you're guided. And so Allah says, yes, they have the guidance. Yes, they are Muslim or whatever the case may be, but many of them are truly fasiqun. Subhanallah. And so Allah is saying, be careful. Be careful not to delude yourself. Be careful not to think that you are something you are not. Because Allah says, I have revealed to you the truth. And the test is, to what extent am I living in accordance to the truth? So Allah says, these are people, long periods of time, disconnected from Allah. Their hearts become hard, desolate places. But then Allah gives you a powerful declaration to open up your heart and your mind. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, اعلموا. This is the next verse. Know for a fact, أن الله يحيي الأرض بعد موتها. الله أكبر. Allah makes a very powerful declaration, and He says, know for a fact that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He brings life to the dead earth. He brings life to the dead earth. Many of us have seen earth that is dry and desolate and dead, but with work it becomes plush and green. And so Allah gives you a powerful metaphor. We may think that our hearts are dead. I don't feel. We say this all the time. I don't feel. I listen to the Quran, I don't feel it. I remember Allah, I don't feel it. I come to the masjid, I don't feel it. My heart is dead. Allah is saying, I know that will happen. Because Allah knows how we operate. But He says no for a fact that He brings life to death. Allah can bring tremendous life from death, and that's what He did to Malik ibn Dinar. A man who was spiritually dead, but Allah sent him signs and they impacted him. First, he received the sign of the man in the marketplace and the daughters. He was moved by that sight. So he said, let me go in that direction. Maybe, that's a good man. Maybe it will guide me. And he stumbled and he broke and he went even worse when his daughter died. But Allah sent him another sign. Sign after sign after sign. And then he committed. And he became one of the most righteous people we know in our history. Wallahi, brothers and sisters, these are not fairy tales. These are truths that we must believe in. Allah is ever merciful. That's why He says, قُلْ يَا عِبَادِيَ الَّذِينَ أَسْرَفُوا عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمْ لَا تَقْنَطُوا مِنْ رَحْمَةِ اللَّهِ. Oh, you those who have overwhelmed themselves with sins and wrongdoings and this and that, never despair from the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَغْفِرُ الذُّنُوبَ جَمِيعًا. Verily Allah says, verily Allah forgives. يَغْفِرُ is فعل مضارع تدل على الاستمرار. It's a verb that indicates ongoing. Allah is continuously forgiving the dhunub, al-dhunub, all of sins. And He will forgive all of them. Wallahi, Allah will forgive all of sins if we just show Allah goodness in our hearts. إِن يَعْلَمِ اللَّهُ فِي قُلُوبِكُمْ خَيْرًا يُؤْتِكُمْ خَيْرًا. If Allah knows that there is goodness in these hearts, wallahi, Allah will bring goodness to these hearts. But there has to be goodness in this heart. I have to become good in my heart. I have to become someone who wants to follow the path of Allah, who loves to follow the path of Allah, someone who embraces the truth of Allah. Put that in your heart and see what Allah will do for you. But that has to start here. There has to be sidq ma'allah, truth, iqbal ala Allah, move towards Allah, fafirru ila Allah, run to Allah. That has to happen here. If Allah knows that there is goodness here, Allah will bring goodness. There was goodness in the heart of Malik ibn Dinar, and Allah brought him goodness. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّهُ هُوَ الْغَفُورُ الرَّحِيمُ. See, if we have any doubts about who Allah is, what Allah is, why does Allah do this to me, and so on and so forth, Allah saying, if you want to know who I am, let me tell you emphatically, without any doubt, إِنَّهُ هُوَ. Verily, He says it twice, to emphasize, Al-Ghafoor, He is the one who is oft forgiving. Ar-Rahim, the one who is so merciful. That is who Allah is. So never despair from Allah. Know that there is always an opportunity to turn to Allah. Know that Allah sends us sign after sign after sign. قَدْ بَيَّنَّا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala concludes the initial verses from Surah Al-Hadid by saying, قَدْ بَيَّنَّا لَكُمُ الْآيَاتِ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَعْقِلُونَ. We have shown you the signs. Subhanallah, look at how Allah speaks. He says, we've shown you sign after sign. Alhamdulillah, everyone in this room has seen countless signs in their life to turn back, to turn back. And Allah in His mercy keeps on sending us signs. And so Allah says, قَدْ بَيَّنَّا لَكُمُ الْآيَاتِ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَعْقِلُونَ. Allah sends you these signs so that you may truly understand. But a more deeper meaning of ta'qilun is not just to understand. But the word ta'qilun comes from aqala shay', meaning to tie something down. And so truly what Allah is saying is, I send you these signs so you can tie your heart to me. That is why Allah sends you the signs, because He wants you to turn back to Him and He wants this heart to be tied to Him. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us a tawbah like the one that was granted to Malik ibn Dinar. May we be people who heed the signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And may we be people who love to run to Allah and to have these hearts tied to Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا وسيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلن تجد له وليا مرشدا. Brothers and sisters, as you leave the masjid today, I request of you one thing. I want you, all of us, myself included, to constantly repeat the verse from Surah Al-Hadid. Is it not time? I want you to put it on your phones. Remind yourselves on your phones. Write it down. Put it in your car. Put it in your home. Let that be constantly in your eyesight. Listen to the gentle reproach of Allah. Is it not time? Alam yatni. Alam yatni. Listen to that and let that be in your face every single day so that you are encouraged. Because just as we continue to see in the life of Malik ibn Dinar, yes, there is a moment where you are inspired, but the journey is long. This dunya is not easy. And the journey towards Allah requires work. It requires riyadah. It requires spiritual practice. We have to engage in it. We have to be people who read the Quran. Because if these hearts are dead and we want them to become alive, like Allah says, then we have Quran to bring light into these dark hearts, the remembrance of Allah to bring light into these dark hearts, prayer to bring light into these dark hearts, to be good to our spouses to bring light into these dark hearts, to take care of our children to bring light into these dark hearts, to take care of our neighbors to bring light into these dark hearts, to do everything that is pleasing to Allah so that we can flush the darkness out and have it replaced with the light of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's work. I wish I could tell you otherwise, but it's work. It takes commitment. It takes resolve. And yes, sometimes darkness will creep back in, but you flush it back out until this heart becomes a beautiful green pasture, alive as Allah promised He will bring life to these hearts. Allah brings life to that which is dead. Never, ever think that this heart is dead. Never. That is not the believer. Allah makes it very clear. The believer never despairs. The only one who despairs is the disbeliever. This heart must always be ready and willing to turn to Allah, no matter how much darkness is here. But let's commit ourselves to that work, bi-ithnillahi ta'ala, and so that Allah will bring life to our hearts. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bring life to our hearts. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to be pleased with us. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive our sins and our shortcomings, to grant us the guidance that was granted to those who are righteous and have preceded us. We ask you, Ya Allah, to make us of those who are on the pathway of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, those who love your book, your guidance, the Quran. Ya Allah, make the Qur'an the light of our hearts in this life and the next. Grant us the healing power of the Qur'an. Grant us the guiding power of the Qur'an. Grant us the light of the Qur'an. Ya Allah, grant us that which is pleasing to you. Allow us to arrange our lives in a manner that is pleasing to you. Allow us to arrange our families in a manner that is pleasing to you. Allow us to arrange our communities in a manner that is pleasing to you. Allow us to leave this earth, Ya Allah, while you are pleased with us. Do not, Ya Allah, allow us to leave this earth while you are displeased with us. Allow us to depart from this earth having been cleansed of all of our sins and having hearts that are alive and well and breathing. Ya Allah, Ya Kareem, Ya Rahman, Ya Rahim. Wa sallallahu ala sayyidina Muhammad wa akhiru da'wana anil hamdulillahi rabbil alameen.